damn New York, young man. I got the meanest streets, the hardest concrete. Right here, in my heart, you and destiny are gonna meet. How can you rise up where others have fallen? Be like me, stand taller.
Got a look.
Be like me, full of life.
Big time delivery.
Because now the struggle to survive gets real.
They stopped officiating this basketball game.
So put the pulse of my streets into your step and step up in the moment of truth.
All the way to the bucket.
But this is the time where winners take their energy through the roof.
Oh, it is his show at the moment.
I am New York City, and this is the Big East Championship.
And welcome to Manhattan, a place where hard work is usually rewarded. Such is the case for the Connecticut Huskies. The long week started Tuesday as UConn knocked off DePaul. And then yesterday, they took care of Georgetown. Today, they face their biggest challenge, the Pittsburgh Panthers. Big East regular season champs who've reached the tournament final 7 times in the last 10 years. Championship Week is presented by Dick's Sporting Goods as we welcome you to the Big East Championship presented by American Eagle Outfitters. UConn has been on the court at Madison Square Garden twice this week. Pitt takes the hardwood for the first time, and the Panthers are 0-2 at the Big East Tournament when they've had the double bye. 16 teams came to New York City. Half have gone home. The winner of our game advances to play either St. John's or Syracuse. The Red Storm prevailing yesterday, of course, in controversial fashion. Later tonight, Notre Dame, Cincinnati, followed by Louisville and Marquette. Hi, everybody, alongside Doris Burke and Fran Fraschilla, I'm Dave Pasch. What a year it's been for Pittsburgh, perhaps already locking up a number one seed in the NCAA tournament. Only 4 losses, Fran, on the year for the Panthers.
When you talk about the success of Pittsburgh, you talk about the culture of execution. That means they screen hard, they move the ball, they take good shots, and most importantly, they offensive rebound. Their offense is predicated on the missed shot. Now, obviously, if Gilbert Brown makes the shot, terrific, but they give themselves a chance to score a second time on every possession because they put their big guys in position to offensive rebound. Watch Gary McGee on the weak side go to work, and he wedges the defender underneath and draws the contact. This team is about execution, and when you talk about their execution, Dave, you got to sprinkle in that large dose of toughness.
And speaking of toughness, how about Kemba Walker for Connecticut in the tournament he's had so far? Doris, he had struggled at Madison Square Garden. He's a New York City guy, but the last 2 games, he's been great.
A special year for a special personality. This guy has proven capable of getting through tough moments, and when you're surrounded by youth, you need a veteran leader who can do that. If you make a mistake in your coverage, he's going to mix his speed. His mid-range is sensational. You don't close the gap on a trap, he will split it and make you look foolish. His handle is tight. He can get to the rim easily. He's shown a propensity to score over bigger defenders and play through contact. Special year for a special young man.
And for Pittsburgh, Bradley Wanamaker epitomizes the toughness in the backcourt that Pitt has had. Think of Krauser, Knight. And Wanamaker is one of those guys that has that versatility to help you in a lot of different ways.
Our starting lineups, guys, for Connecticut, Jeremy Lamb, averaging 15 points per game so far in the Big East tournament, joining Walker along with Roscoe Smith, Alex Oriaki, and Charles Okwundu in the middle for 23-9 UConn. Pittsburgh 27-4, 4th regular season title the last decade. Gibbs, who's a terrific player, first team all Big East, along with Wanamaker, Brown, Nasir Robinson, and Gary McGee. Our officials are John Cal, Brian O'Connell, and Gary Prager. And as I'm sure you've heard reported already, the 3 Big East officials who worked the Rutgers St. John's game yesterday with a controversial ending, Jim Bird, Tim Higgins, Earl Walton, have, according to the Big East, voluntarily stepped away from calling any more games here at the Big East tournament. The league would not comment on whether there will be further punishment for next season. UConn will start with the basketball. And here's Okwundu, who's been pretty solid so far here in New York, but he misfires there. And Gilbert Brown gets it ahead to Ashton Gibbs. Gibbs missed three games in the middle of the year with a knee injury. Pitt was 3-0 without him, but really not the same team. They struggled, especially offensively, while Gibbs was out with that sprained MCL.
Well, the thing they missed most without him is his ability to shoot the three ball. And that's the one significant area where he is so important. And what a release, Franny. Gibbs has got such a great release and a pretty pure jump shot.
Shot clock down to five. Here's Wanamaker for three. And Oriaki with the rebound. He had 19 against DePaul. That tied a school record at the Big East tournament. They've gone to Okwundu twice here to start the game. He's 0-for-2.
What I like about going inside against Pittsburgh is you got to match their toughness.
Robinson with the game's first basket out in transition.
Now, Pittsburgh's two losses, Louisville and St. John's, it was noticeable Nasir Robinson was not himself. Their staff believes that guy is the key to their success. The guys around him, Fran, are very consistent.
Absolutely. Nasir Robinson is a versatile inside-out power-type player. Wanamaker has the matchup early on Kemba. This will be fun.
Walker, 26 points against DePaul, 28 yesterday, and he's shooting about 50% from the field. And that is a two. He has not hit a three yet in the tournament. Knocks down the long jumper there.
And normally you get a smile out of him. He's all business, it looks like, today.
I agree.
UConn is the 9 seed, ranked 19th in the country. That tells you about just how good the Big East is. Pittsburgh has all 4 points coming from Nasir Robinson, a junior from Chester, PA.
You wonder, Fran, if that's a call from the sideline. They want to make sure he's engaged and locked in.
He's a hard matchup because, again, he's a forward who's very versatile.
A block there by Wanamaker on Walker, and numbers for Pittsburgh. Here's Robinson again in transition. Okwundu got the block. Here's the talented freshman Jeremy Lamb, all Big East rookie team, only going to get better as time goes on.
Outstanding decision, and Kemba Walker sprints to the corner to drag the defender with him, Fran, and you got no choice if you're Jeremy. You make the absolute right choice. Pull up. Nobody stops you. You pull up and get that jump shot.
You know, his eyes went to Walker, and the defense went to Walker.
Wanamaker able to bank it in. The unsung hero on this Pittsburgh team, senior from Philly, was named second team All Big East.
I always felt, Dave, when you played a team like Pittsburgh, that you have to match their toughness early. You got to punch the bully in the nose before they punch you in the nose.
Dribbling by Lamb. He's got a wrap on his right knee. Hurt that in UConn's final regular season game against Notre Dame, but it has not bothered him here in New York. Oriaki with three on the shot clock puts up a brick.
Well, he put up a brick because there's a lot of bricks in that Gary McGee wall.
Gibbs three is good. He led the Big East in three-point shooting during the regular season. Timeout, UConn.
When you talk about Pittsburgh, you do talk about the culture of toughness, but they also have the X factor, Ashton Gibbs, who you've got to locate early in transition.
Guys, in talking with some folks involved with the Pitt program before the game, I think there's a chip on their shoulders. They felt that they were snubbed in terms of the awards postseason. Yes, Wanamaker is the basket is good by Coombs McDaniel. Wanamaker won the sportsmanship award, but they felt McGee could have easily won defensive player of the year and that Gibbs should have gotten more attention for player of the year.
Well, the way I feel about it is I'd rather have a great team than a collection of really good players, and they have a great basketball team.
The other would be coach of the year Jamie Dixon as Gibbs gets the bucket and the foul. 3-point opportunity for Ashton Gibbs. He's already got 5 points.
One of the outstanding matchups to watch early in this basketball game. One of the most gifted offensive players in the league, Kemba Walker. The hard dribble at the step back makes it an easy one and nothing but net. Mr. Wanamaker, he's going to give as good as he gets today. They're going to hit you. They're going to hit you hard. You better be prepared for it.
back in New York City at Madison Square Garden, where Pittsburgh Panther head coach Jamie Dixon is 18-10. That does include a loss to St. John's last month here at MSG. But Dixon has more wins than any other coach in Division I history through 8 seasons. Of course, the elusive Final Four. The last time Pitt was in a Final Four was 1941. Wasn't all that difficult to get there if you got in, though. There were only 8 teams that made the field.
Extraordinary success without a first-round draft pick. Not a self-promoter, just wants to coach his basketball team. I admire him greatly, Fran.
Well, and the fact that he moved from one seat to the other as an assistant to the head coaching job and has done a wonderful job. But by the way, guys like Tom Izzo and Jim Boeheim are good role models.
Wham up high and slams it down on the alley-oop.
Always like to see what coaches do out of a timeout. And that time they took advantage of Pittsburgh's pressure and they snuck Lamb behind the little double back screen.
Second assist for Kemba Walker. Now Robinson, already with 4 points, will go to the free throw line. That's the second team foul on UConn.
Well, watch Lamb now. He's just going to come off that double to the rim. It's a set play. Excellent delivery. It's important against Pittsburgh to try to get as many easy baskets as you can because they don't come around very often.
Foul on Oriaki is first. Nasir Robinson was hurt in the preseason, a knee surgery in October, missed the first 3 games, so he wasn't in the starting lineup until about the midway point of the year. He's a solid player. Averaged 5 rebounds per game, 10 points in Big East games. Had a double-double and the victory against Connecticut back in December when Pitt won that game handily, their only meeting during the regular year. Ashton Gibbs now has 8 points.
This is a Ruby. You mentioned the chip on their shoulder. It's about more than just being snubbed in the postseason awards, to be honest with you. They've been knocked out of this. You've touched on that in the open the last couple years. They have talked often and together about succeeding here in New York and playing deep into this Big East tournament.
First Pitt foul.
And when you talk about Pittsburgh now, keep an eye on the offensive rebound. Watch Gilbert Brown. You cannot let Pitt get second chance opportunities. They thrive off the opportunity to get their own misses.
McGee picked up the foul, so Oriaki at the line. Well, Pitt is used to having success here at the Big East tournament. They won it in 08. They actually went to the championship game 4 straight years. And from 2002 to 2004, they played UConn in the title game. They won in 03, lost in 02 and 04.
Consistency of habits. Jamie Dixon is a creature of habit. He gets these guys into a routine. Now, they had to switch that coming here. Because they're playing a noon game, they practiced very early the last several days.
Gibbs hits a three. He's got 11. And Pitt leads by 10.
Isn't it amazing that you know he can hurt you and you game plan for him and he still gets loose?
At 89 threes to lead the league during the regular season. Kemba Walker missing the shot. And if that's Oriaki, it's number 2. So 2 personals on Oriaki.
Watch this. Brad Wanamaker is the one guy that can go off the dribble. Watch the freeze because he gets into the heart of the defense, the pitch to the corner. This is plenty of time for Mr. Gibbs and that pretty release. This is why Brad Wanamaker, and I talked to George Blaine, they voted Brad Wanamaker first team Big East. He said, I'm stunned he's not there.
And we mentioned that great tradition. You think of Brandon Knight first and Paul Krauser. And then LaVance Fields, the one common denominator with Brad Wanamaker, toughness.
Out of bounds. And it will stay Pitt basketball with 8 to shoot. Jim Calhoun, now 300 Big East wins. That includes regular season, Big East tournament. Only Jim Boeheim previously had reached that plateau. A team that started 10-0 was 17-2 at one point, lost 4 of 5 heading into New York City. Robinson to the basket. He's attacking here early on and got 7 points. Pitt has made its last 6 from the field.
Heavy dose of pick and roll defense that Pitt's going to throw at Kemba Walker. He's going to have to really read with intelligence.
Smith off the dribble is pushed by Robinson. That's his first second on Pitt. Now, Jim Calhoun making some news yesterday when it was announced that he would not appeal a three-game Big East suspension that will take place next year. And the school reportedly won't appeal other sanctions, including 3 years probation, reduction of scholarships, and restrictions on recruiting. Aquandu had it swatted away. And it's underneath, and then a rebound by Taylor, fouled by Aquandu. Good work by Dante Taylor off the bench. Fourth team foul.
Boy, this looked like a sure basket by Aquandu. Take a look, little slip inside, and Dante Taylor, a guy that is a McDonald's All-American. You talk about checking your ego at the door, Doris. He doesn't start. He knows how much work he's got to do to keep improving. Solid off the bench.
Gibbs 4 for 4 from the field already in the game, as Pitt leads by 12. Brown lost it. Aquandu ahead to Walker. Walker with the spin in the lane and a great strip by Trayvon Woodall. It will stay UConn ball.
You think back to the first meeting, and Kemba struggled a little bit shooting the basketball, and they've talked an awful lot about funneling him, making sure they're directing Kemba where they want him to go. Their big players, their post players are an important part of that franchise.
Yeah, you know what, Doris, I thought was important, Dave, in that first game. UConn came in 10-0. Kemba was on a roll, but they geared the entire defense, and even though he got 31, it was 10 of 27.
Correct.
It was one of those volume shooting nights that we saw from him in the Big East.
Lamar Patterson on the floor now for Pittsburgh. Their bench a little bit thinner. Talib Zana, who during horseplay broke his right thumb, missed the last 4 games of the regular season. They expect him back for the NCAA tournament, maybe not the first round. As Roscoe Smith hits a three, had only 3 points yesterday against Georgetown, so he's already matched that mark. At 10, Woodall with the ball in his hands gives it up to Gibbs with 3. Woodall beats the shot clock buzzer from here in Brooklyn, went to St. Anthony's in New Jersey, and gives Pitt a 12-point lead. Walker has it blocked by Patterson. Smith pulls it out and will settle things down. Coombs McDaniel, though, couldn't handle the pass. Unforced error.
Well, when you think about Pittsburgh and how they built their program, it's been about tough guards from places like New York, New Jersey, Philadelphia. Ashton Gibbs is the prototype. He can score in a lot of different ways. He leads, and he makes big shots, and why not? It's the Garden.
In New York City, where Pittsburgh has a 12-point lead on 9 of 11 shooting from the field.
So one thing you know about Pittsburgh, you will not stop them from running their stuff. And you can see what Ashton Gibbs has done already. 4 for 4 field goals. He's yet to miss a shot. But there was that play moments before we went to break where that shot clock was right down to 0, and they make a play. They're going to force you to guard for a full 35 seconds. And, you know, you can talk about being physical defensively. This is a physical offensive team. And if you're Kemba Walker, there are signs of frustration. Ashton Gibbs is using his offhand to get a little space for Kemba Walker. Boy, they're going to test you both ends with their physicality.
Hey, guess what? Nobody likes to be screened hard.
Yes, true.
And that's what Pitt does.
Now Gibbs on the bench now. Let's see. It's a 12-point Panther lead with Gibbs on the pine. Wanamaker wild shot. Shabazz Napier, freshman, on the floor for the first time today. Gets Smith in transition, and he's fouled. That's on Patterson, his first 13 foul on Pitt. Roscoe Smith, another freshman for Connecticut, will go to the line. It's a young team. It's one of the reasons why UConn was picked 10th preseason. And when that came out, they weren't thinking Connecticut would be a 500 team in the league. They were thinking something like 6-12, especially after their 12th place finish last year. So it was a surprising year for the Huskies.
I think if you think back to November, and we all remember where we were doing games, and I think you and I, Doris, were here in the Garden, there's no question, when they won the Maui Classic, it stunned me to beat Michigan State and to beat Kentucky. And certainly everybody in the Big East has their ups and downs, but they've had a remarkable year when you think of the quality wins that they've had.
I think if you know Jim Calhoun's history, you know that he seems to like it when his back is up against the wall and he's got something to prove.
I think he leads the league in smiles this year, which is a first for Calhoun.
That's a great point.
And he's really enjoyed coaching his team. Wanamaker lost the ball. Connecticut trying to get it back down to single digits.
Now they're Gilbert Brown right now guarding Kemba Walker away from the ball. Now they switch back.
Walker just 1 of 4 from the field. He does have 2 assists. Ball in his hands against the taller defender. He'll take it down the lane and finish beautifully with the left hand.
One thing you have to ask yourself is, can you run your offense against Pittsburgh? And good patience by Connecticut. I think this is as much of, I don't know that because of their young legs, this will be a physical test as much as it will be for a mental test, especially for the youngsters, Napier and Lamb.
Midway through the first half, Pitts lead down to 8. From the corner, a 3-point try by Brown and a foul. So it'll be 3 free throws as Okwundu commits the personal, his second. He and Oriaki both with 2.
Take a look at this, guys. They switch out. Dante Taylor's got Walker. Now, this is a mismatch. They got to help and support a little bit. But watch Kemba get into that crease, get to the rim, and nobody rotates over. That's great recognition. Kemba knows that there's no way Dante Taylor is going to be able to stay in front of him.
And if you're Trayvon Woodall, you're going, okay, that's marked up in the coach's tape. I'll be hearing about that tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Olander was about to check in, but has to wait, says Gary Prager. Olander didn't play yesterday after starting against DePaul, but he's got to play some minutes now with both Oriaki and Okwundu in foul trouble as Gilbert Brown gets both. He's got one more free throw coming.
Outside of the fact, I think, guys, that Pittsburgh has shot the ball very well, I don't see any sense of fear on the part of Connecticut. They are battling, but now foul trouble becomes a major issue for them.
Giffey on the floor for UConn, along with Olander, Napier, Smith, and Kemba Walker. Spin by Napier, might have been contact, no whistle, and it's going to go to Pittsburgh as Napier was on the end line when he had possession. Okay, good call there by our officiating crew. 11-point lead for Pittsburgh. 9 of 12 shooting. Make it 9 of 13. Wanamaker, no, but it was touched last by Gary McGee, so it's UConn ball. Winner of this game advances to the semifinals. UConn has lost 3 consecutive quarterfinal games after winning 10 in a row. They have won the Big East tournament 6 times, but not since 2004. It's tough to win 5 games in 5 days. No one's done it yet. UConn is one of 3 teams to play 4 games at the Big East Championship. That was in 2000. Napier along the baseline got stripped. Still plenty of time to shoot. Here it is in Walker's hands with 6. Walker lost it. Gibbs ahead of the pack. Napier will challenge. And it's last touch by Connecticut. No foul.
Now you can see how they have ganged up on Kemba Walker a little bit on a defensive end. You almost have to, and it's obvious, you have to make somebody else beat you. Cannot allow Kemba to get going.
They felt like they did a pretty good job being in the gaps, even though they gave up 31. As you said, it was an inefficient scoring night for Kemba Walker. He went on a late run in that game too, and it was, you know, pretty well decided.
Brown can't hit the short jumper. Up high for the rebound is Roscoe Smith, who did average 5 boards per game in the regular season.
How about those 4 freshmen right now out there for Jim Calhoun?
Here's Walker. And a blocking foul is called. That's on Robinson, his second. Fourth team foul on Pitt.
How about the hard crossover? A crossover dribble should take you someplace, Fran. It's got to take you by a defender and toward the rim. Well, if you're going to use that weapon, make sure it's taking you somewhere. And it took them by two white jerseys. I thought it was the right call.
One more free throw for Kemba Walker. As J.J. Richardson will replace Robinson, who's got two fouls. Walker, first team all Big East. Second in the league in scoring, led the league in minutes. And against the six top 10 teams that UConn played this year, he averaged almost 30 points per game. Walker's got six. Gibbs has 11 to lead all scorers. Pitt has missed this last four shots from the field after making seven straight. McGee in the low block. And he's grabbed by Olander. His first.
This is good recognition by Pittsburgh. Olander is a guy that's not a physical player. Oriaki's out, Okwandu's out, so they go into McGee, even though he's not the type of scoring threat that the perimeter players are.
This time, Brown out of the inbounds play, able to hit the baseline, Jay.
You know, I love inbounds plays when you work on them 5-on-0 because they always end up with a shot. And there's a situation where Gilbert Brown, twice in a row, doesn't even think about it. He's open, he shoots it.
Walker to Olander. And boy, that'll help if he's hitting those jumpers. Average just 1 point per game during the season.
He went stretches during the Big East season where he didn't even take a shot.
He didn't play against Notre Dame in UConn's last regular season game. Gibbs with the floater. Boy, Ashton Gibbs with his fifth field goal already.
They challenged him to be able to put it on the deck a little bit. Now, he's not as good as Wanamaker, but he's getting there. And you know, on the offseason, that'll be the next step for him. But that floater, if you're a guard in this league or any league, you better be able to have that floater at your disposal.
Lamb and a late whistle by John Cal, but a foul is called on Gibbs, his first and the fifth team foul. Ashton Gibbs, first team all Big East, a spectacular junior guard from West Orange, New Jersey, is 5 of 6 from the field, has 13 points as Pitt leads here in New York by 11. All right, Mike, good to hear your voice again in studio today. Pitt leading UConn by 11 here in our quarterfinal. Number one, had an injury as Roscoe Smith takes a shot to the face, but inadvertent here, as you can see. Gary McGee flying in, blooding just above the right eye of Roscoe Smith. The officials went immediately to the monitor to look and see if there was an excessive elbow foul or flagrant foul, but they looked quickly and saw that it was just incidental and got the call correct.
Another day in the Big East. A little blood,
oh, man.
Some contact. What else is new?
Guys, do you think the officials in general today and the rest of the Big East tournament are going to feel a little bit more pressure on themselves based on what happened yesterday? I mean, these guys over the course of a year work a lot of games and have to turn the page pretty quickly. Is that possible for these guys still working?
Of course they feel the scrutiny. How can you not? In the day and age we live in, where there's so much media coverage.
Well, I think they're going to stay even more alert than they normally are. Remember, these guys are all rested because they haven't repped since last weekend for the most part.
And you've got a bunch of different officials as Gibbs hits again. A group of officials working the Big East tournament, but they're not working every day. And they are not told until, as far as we know, after all the games are completed that day, whether they are working the next day and what game they are working. As Lamb gets in the lane and Wanamaker with a rebound. They'll slow it up. And as mentioned, the three officials who worked the Rutgers St. John's game yesterday, Jim Burr, who is here in the stands, by the way, today, along with Tim Higgins and Earl Walton, are voluntarily stepping away from working any more games in the Big East tournament. And has no bearing on the NCAA tournament, not necessarily anything for next season, although the Big East would not comment on any further punishment for next year. As Lamb drives the lane, and he's starting to get it going for UConn. That forces Jamie Dixon to call a timeout. John Marinato, the Big East commissioner, came out with a statement shortly before the tip of today's game, saying our officials are a very dedicated and loyal group of professionals who care deeply about the Big East Conference in the best interest of everyone involved, including coaches, student athletes, game officials, and Big East member institutions. The officials who were assigned the St. John's Rutgers game Wednesday have voluntarily withdrawn for the remainder of the 2011 Big East Championship. With 3 days of competition remaining, it's our hope everyone will now focus on our outstanding teams and the exciting games ahead. And as mentioned, Jim Burr is here. Jim has worked 16 Final Fours. Tim Higgins, who worked yesterday's game, 10 Final Fours. So these guys have done a lot of games.
Earl, who is not as long tenured as Tim Higgins and Jim Burr. And listen, outside of the kids at Rutgers, there's probably no one who had less sleep than those three gentlemen. And I'm not softening my stance in any way, shape, or form. They made mistakes. They know they made mistakes. Like a player who misses free throws at a game-winning attempt. You don't sleep. It sickens you. But these men care, I think, Fran, about what they do, and they're invested. And the Big East made it clear to the three of us before the game that they support these guys long term.
McGee, no. Rebound, Wanamaker, back up, and a foul.
Well, if you ask me, and I coached 23 years, Jim Burr could officiate any of my games, and he did many games. Take a look now. You'll see that Burrell steps on the line. Everybody thinks the game is over. Brownlee, I'm sorry.
Possible travel, possible out of bounds.
I think the coaching move by Steve Lavin was great, because everybody thought the game was over when he started walking midcourt. But let me make this point. As a head coach, I had Jim Burr many, many times. Not only is he a great official, but he was one of those guys that if he had a problem with you, he would never let it carry over to the next game. And I concur with Doris. Nobody outside of Mike Rice and his team feels any worse. And I watched him officiate this year. He had a very good season. And yesterday happened to be one of those games, like a player missing a free throw or a coach making a mistake. They made a mistake yesterday.
Pittsburgh on top, 35-23, 5.5 to go here in the first. Napier will take the three and hit it.
Best part about that young man, besides his basketball skill, is his confident demeanor. And he has no fear.
I think the freshmen have been very confident today. Smith, Napier, that's a push-off.
No whistle, though. Brown on the drive, short again, got it back, got stripped. Here's Kemba Walker in transition. Walker, 2 of 5 from the field, 6 points, 3 assists. And Napier fouled before the shot on the floor. It's the 16th foul on Pittsburgh. UConn's committed 17 fouls.
I've said this all season long. If there's one thing the officials need to do in an intense environment, is blow the whistle very early in both halves and establish a tempo of the game. You can't let a guy get away with a push-off and gain an advantage. Blow the whistle, the players will adjust.
Walker with the step-back three. And Woodall with the board. Napier breaking up the pass. Woodall able to get it back. Find Wanamaker. His long two not there. Here's Coombs McDaniel inside. Count it. And a foul.
Love it. This is, if you think back to the losses Pittsburgh had against Tennessee and Texas, those teams took their opportunities to transition them, and you can get your moments. It might come in spurts, Fran, but they will give you an opportunity and go right into the chest of the defender.
Absolutely.
Nice.
I like it. Not only do you run, but if you get it inside, you got to play, you know, match fire with fire and go right at Gary McGee, who's one of the best low post defenders in college basketball.
So, guys, now the four key bigs, McGee and Robinson for Pitt, Okwundu and Oriaki for UConn, all with two personal fouls.
And that's letting them play.
but I like it.
Me too.
Yep.
Oriaki is the only one of those four who's on the floor right now. As UConn has climbed back within six at the four-minute mark.
Oh, nice.
Wanamaker from Gibbs. Great look by Ashton Gibbs.
That's Steve Nash style. Go to the baseline behind the rim, and it's almost what we said yesterday. It's like Wayne Gretzky behind the goal in hockey. Make the play from behind the rim.
Foul on Dante Taylor on the step out. Pittsburgh in the top five in the country this year in assists. Dante Taylor's first personal. 18 foul. Ashton Gibbs, perhaps upset that he wasn't named Player of the Year in the Big East. Taking it out on UConn. He's got 16 points. He's missed one shot, and he has three assists, including that one, the Wanamaker. And Mike, a spot on the semifinals at stake here in New York as Pittsburgh leads Connecticut by eight.
Well, Ashton Gibbs is a guy, remember, only played 10 minutes a game as a freshman. Jamie Dixon coached the United States under 19 team two summers ago. They were running out of point guards. He volunteered his freshman, who really didn't do very much their freshman year. Ashton Gibbs took control of that team. They won the gold medal. And his sophomore year was brilliant, and he's picked up where he left off doors as a junior.
You've got to be patient as a youngster. I think Sam Young, Brad Wanamaker, go down the list of Pittsburgh players who don't play their freshman season. And Jamie Dixon said, I want them to be upset. I want them to be competitive enough in spirit that they're bothered by not playing. But I imagine, Fran, it takes some skill as a head coach to sort of keep guys patient and not get transfer, not get impatient, not get the noise around the players to impact their decision to want to stay or go.
Well, if you go to Pittsburgh, you know you're going to a true program where very few guys leave early, and that means you do wait your turn. J.J. Moore is a good example, outstanding freshman who people haven't heard from yet.
Walker with 8 points now, and you could argue the San Antonio Spurs would not have the best record in the league without DeJuan Blair. Blair, not a first-round pick, but has had a huge impact in the NBA. As Woodall can't rattle it home, the tip won't go, and UConn can cut it to four, maybe three. Napier in the Wanamaker off the window.
You see what I mean about transitioning against? They will give you some opportunities. The key is taking advantage of Napier's handle, Fran.
Oh, yeah.
I agree. They're a good team when the ball's in his hand.
Yep, and he took it right at Wanamaker, too, and Wanamaker stepped away from him.
Gibbs trying to come off the screen, and aggressive defense by Kemba Walker. Wanamaker. Pass too hot to handle for Taylor. And on the possession arrow, it will stay. Pit ball with eight to shoot.
Quarterfinal game. Both of these teams are in the NCAA tournament, and they say conference tournaments don't matter. How about that?
You could make a case that winning this could be as tough as winning the national championship.
Yeah, because in UConn's case, you got to play five games in 5 days.
Instead of winning six games in 3 weeks, as the basket is good by Gilbert Brown. I remember Bob Knight said that during the year, that it might be harder to win the Big East tournament than it is to win the NCAA tournament.
And I also think it's even harder to go 15-3 in a regular season than it is to win the NCAA tournament.
The regular season champ in the Big East, as Walker is fouled, has won the Big East tournament championship twice in the last 4 years. Walker taking a shot to the face. That happened yesterday to him as well. Spot in the semifinals on the line. The winner of this game will play either Syracuse, St. John's, and you see the other two quarters tonight, Notre Dame and Louisville, the better seeds entering those games.
I'll tell you what, how about Marquette? They needed two wins to get it done. I got a text, guys, late last night from Buzz Williams, and I said, congratulations. He said, Coach, we're a bunch of nobodies, including the coach. We've never been in Times Square before. We just want to spend another night in New York City.
9 points now for Gibbs. First foul on Wanamaker, 19 foul. Buzz continues to have that aw shucks mentality. His guys play hard. They practice and play hard. Would you agree?
Absolutely. As hard as anybody you'll see during the year. Maybe, you know, there are teams that play as hard, but how about Buzz Williams and Mick Cronin? Two real nobodies, two guys that weren't great players who've done unbelievable coaching jobs in a league of great coaches.
Kemba Walker with 10, Gibbs with 16, the two leading scorers as Pitt turns it over. Here's Walker, so good in transition, and there he goes again. It's a two-point game.
They are just getting loose. What they're doing is they're matching the physical and mental toughness of Pittsburgh. They're saying, game on, fellas, we're here. You punch me, I'll punch you right back.
14-4 run by UConn in the last 3.5. They had 26 fast break points on Tuesday against DePaul. As Woodall traveled, UConn can tie or take the lead on this possession.
It'll be tough. A little steal here, and then all of a sudden, numbers. You've got the defense on their heels, and he knows if they're on their heels, I'm coming right into your chest.
You know, sometimes, guys, it takes as much mental toughness to be the favorite in a conference tournament than it does to be the underdog. We saw that yesterday with St. John's. They didn't play well, but they weathered the storm.
No pun intended.
No pun intended.
Walker keeping the dribble. Going baseline, travel.
I'll tell you what, Dante Taylor did a sensational job defensively because he refused to let Kemba Walker get to the screen. And then he's right down here. So as the teammate gets beat, there's a lot of white jerseys sitting there waiting for Kemba. But it was his defense early. He refused to let Kemba get to the screen.
Well, there's a lot in Taylor's white jersey as well.
Yeah, there is.
Was that the right call? Did he travel there?
Looked like, I thought he dragged his pivot.
A minute to go here in the first. Pittsburgh on top of UConn by 2. Pitt the 1 seed for the 3rd time in school history. Ranked 3rd in the country. Perhaps already a 1 seed locked up in the big dance. Turnover by Pitt. 3-on-3. It's Napier ahead of the pack. Oriaki's tip ties it up at 39. Points for UConn off of Pittsburgh turnovers.
Watch the hands of Shabazz Napier. Jim Calhoun told us earlier in the year he's one of the best young defensive guards he's ever had. He creates the steal, the breakaway, and then the foul at the other end.
And does it feel like all of Connecticut's baskets here in the latter stages of the second half are transition paint points, tough twos, because they are being as physically aggressive on the defensive end as their counterpart?
You know, it's a great point, Doris, because I don't think they can beat Pittsburgh in a half-court game, but they do have the speed of guys like Walker and Napier to get some easy baskets in the open court. They're using the 94 feet wisely.
Both teams shooting over 50% so far in the game. Connecticut 2-of-4 from 3. Pitt 4-of-5. Gibbs the leading scorer with 16 points. Walker has 12 for UConn. It's Pitt ball, tie game. About a 4-second difference between game and shot clocks here at the end of the first half from MSG. Gibbs, Woodall, and Wanamaker, 3 guards, along with Brown, kind of a guard slash forward, and Dante Taylor. Shot clock at 10. Double team comes to Wanamaker. He lost the ball. Here's Walker. Swatted away, but a foul with 6 seconds left.
You understand that a lot of times they are trying to get Ashton Gibbs the ball on either a stagger, a flare, and this was the thinking. There was a flare screen, but Wanamaker just went a little bit early in his decision-making, had nowhere to go. UConn had collapsed on him, and they're playing terrific defense.
Well, you know what they're doing? If you're going to give up something, you're going to give up some threes, but what you've got to do with Pittsburgh, I think, is keep them out of the paint where they can make plays and also crash the offensive glass.
Wanamaker picking up his 2nd foul. Kemba Walker missed the first. UConn has its first lead of the game. Pit ball with 6 seconds left. Patterson back on the floor for the Panthers, replacing Taylor. Here's Woodall.
You don't need a high screen. Just give him room to drive. That's it.
Woodall down the lane. Got it to go as the buzzer sounds. runs, and Pitt takes the lead into the locker room.
Well, what I like about this, Dave, is oftentimes the screen at the top of the key brings another defender. There's room for Woodall to get through, slip by, and hit the little runner.
Beth Mullen standing by with Pitt coach Jamie Dixon.
Thank you very much, Dave. Well, what's the message in the locker room, Jamie, to your guys about the transition defense?
Well, it's turnovers that got us going, and that's how they're getting the transition. So you got to take care of the ball first off and obviously get your guys back. But take care of the ball. It's the first thing we got to do.
Foul trouble with a couple of the big guys.
Yeah,
how's that affecting things?
A lot of fouls, and we got to do a better job of keeping our feet. Somehow we're getting some reaching fouls, and we got to do a better job with that.
Thank you.
All right, Beth, Pitt shooting 60% from the field, but just a one-point lead at halftime. And it's New Yorker Trayvon Woodall from Brooklyn with the shot that puts Pitt ahead at the break, 41-40. Cisco halftime report coming your way with Mike Tirico in studio.
I am New York, young man. This week on this court, the stakes like my skyscrapers are higher, the glare like my light brighter. If you're afraid, you'll fail. But stand tall like me and you will prevail. Here in the Big East Championship.
And welcome back to Championship Week presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. It's the 2011 Big East Championship presented by American Eagle Outfitters. Pittsburgh on top of Connecticut by one back here at the Garden. For a while, looked like the Huskies were going to get run out of the gym. Dave Pad, Fran Fraschilla, Doris Burke with you. But Connecticut makes a run. Kemba Walker gets out in transition, and it's essentially a brand new game.
Yeah, and I think for Pittsburgh, if what you're worried about is you shot 60% from the field, and you're only up 1 point because what you talked about, Dave, Kemba Walker and UConn has run on Pittsburgh. They're getting out in transition. They got 10 points off the break, and this has definitely been a bone of contention in that locker room at halftime for the Panthers.
Well, I think the most important thing UConn did was they competed defensively, as physically and mentally tough as their counterpart today. Everybody is in position. Everybody has head to basketball. Everybody sees that somebody's in trouble on dribble penetration. Active hands leads to transition. The push ahead pass, the adjustment by Napier, they've been outstanding against a Pittsburgh team that has shown a propensity to be able to run against.
Doris, our first half stats brought to you by American Eagle. Fran, you talked about the outstanding shooting by Pittsburgh. Connecticut shot it pretty well. 12 of 15 free throws. That's where Walker got most of his points. He was 7 of 8 at the line, 13 points. Ashton Gibbs, 16 points to lead Pitt. 6 of 7 for Gibbs from the floor. Perfect from three-point land. Walker missing to start the second half, but Oriaki got the offensive rebound. And McGee eventually controls after the Lamb miss. Winner advances to the semifinals to play either St. John's or Syracuse. That's our next game here at the Garden. Pittsburgh has won the Big East Tournament Championship twice, 08-03. As McGee gets inside and is fouled, couldn't convert. First foul in the half. And Gary McGee, only a 49% free throw shooter, will go to the line.
And Dave, Roscoe Smith has 8 stitches. They are not going to play him in the second half. They're going to be very cautious, obviously, with the thought of next week in the NCAA tournament.
And Smith, as Oriaki picks up his third foul, goes to the bench. Got elbowed accidentally by McGee when he was going in for a rebound near the eye, and saw a lot of blood flowing in that first half on that incidental hit.
There's a guy who can make shots and the offensive rebound, so we'll see how much they miss of that in this second half.
James McDaniel getting a lot of minutes the last month or so of the season for Connecticut on the floor now after Oriaki goes to the bench. Taking Brown to the hole, lost the ball. Land there for UConn. And another player taking a shot to the face. It's Coombs McDaniel. May have happened on that drive. And certainly Pitt, one of the more physical teams. Case in point right there. The shot of Roscoe Smith with the Band-Aid. Pittsburgh among the nation's leaders in rebound margin. and leading the Big East in points allowed in field goal defense in conference games as Coombs McDaniel will get looked at. McQuandu along with Giffey, Olander, Lamb, and Walker out there for UConn. Accidentally swiped by Brown on the way up. Walker. Here's Giffey. Way off for the three, and Nasir Robinson snares the rebound. Gibbs for three. Ashton Gibbs, 4 of 4 from three-point land, 19 points.
Boy, how pure is that stroke? Good rhythm jump shot.
Walker, no. And Robinson tracks down the loose ball. Gibbs, the leading scorer with 19 points with a great pass. No basket. As McGee missed anyway, but it's a foul on the floor and Okwandu is third.
Now, you can make him a point guard, but this is the thing he does best. There's a switch on the screen, so Olander, in allowing Walker to come up and recover, gives him enough space to shoot the shot.
And guess what happens after the next time down? Olander's got to be worried about Gibbs' shot, and there's a good inbounds play.
And Giffey fouling immediately as looked like there was going to be a basket underneath, so Giffey picks up his first 13 foul. With Oriaki and Okwandu out, can Connecticut win? There were times in the first half where they looked like they're actually better off with those guys on the bench.
Yeah, but over the course of this game, remember, Pittsburgh only had 3 offensive rebounds in the first half, and that's likely to change, Dave, because of the fact that UConn now is a little bit undermanned.
Think about this, Fran. Back-to-back games in the first 2 over this Big East tournament, Connecticut shot 50%. Consecutive games for the first time all year. They were 50% in the first half. Now that has come back here a little bit in the second half.
Well, for me, coaching, it was always about the first 3 minutes of each half. And Pittsburgh has got to come out right now and put a knockout punch on UConn.
Gibbs with the steal. To Brown, couldn't handle it.
Time Gibbs was too unselfish. He should have taken it to the rim and made Lamb commit to him.
The rare mental error by Pittsburgh. You just don't see that a lot out of a Jamie Dixon team.
Go to the rim. See, Lamb never got in front and forced Gibbs to make the commitment. Gibbs should have went right to the rim until Lamb cut him off.
Hit the 1 seed, ranked 3rd in the nation at 27-4. Losses Notre Dame, St. John's here at the Garden, Louisville, and Tennessee on a neutral floor. Kicked ball, shot clock to 15. Connecticut at 23-9, 9-9 in the Big East, the 9 seed. Wins over DePaul in Georgetown, and Jim Calhoun getting his 300th Big East win yesterday. Walker again breaking down the defense. What a spectacular move to the goal and the foul.
Yesterday I kept talking about how many tough twos Kemba Walker makes. And in that first half he had 13 points and 4 assists. So he was involved in virtually all of the scoring. There's a lot of white jerseys. This is a special shot by a special talent, friend, because that is splitting 4 white jerseys against one of the best defensive teams in the entire country.
Exactly, Doris. And what Gilbert Brown did is instead of getting his full body on Walker, he just got a hand in there. And Walker went through it like he had an easy pass on the Triborough Bridge.
We showed that visual of the traffic moving in the Lincoln Tunnel. I said, clearly they're not there at the right hour.
And McGee on the bench, by the way, guys, with 3 fouls now. So you get 3 key bigs with 3 personal fouls. Gibbs leaves it for Taylor. He blew it. Got it back. We'll get another chance. Way off again. Here's Walker in transition. Behind the back. And Lamb will pull it out.
See how they get the ball right to Napier. That allows Kemba to take a breather on offense a little bit. And the defense doesn't focus on him when he has the ball.
Walker for 3. Board by Wanamaker. Wanamaker racing back down court. Out to Gibbs. He still has not missed from three-point land. 22 points in the game. Timeout UConn. Now at some point, if you're UConn, you get a hand in the face of number 12.
Yeah, that was a freshman mistake, Dave, because when the ball went inside, Napier took his eyes off the most dangerous guy in the building. Take a look now. Just a breakdown. Ball goes in, back out to Gibbs. Napier's standing around like a guy trying to hail a cab out in front of the Garden.
Today's telecast available in 3D on ESPN 3D, brought to you by Sony. All games of the Big East Championship in 3D. Pittsburgh on top by 7. Ashton Gibbs, 8 of 9 from the field. Perfect from 3-point land.
Well, just like he did in the first half, he had 16 points in the first 13 minutes. Fran, he's come out of the gates here in the second half in similar fashion, making shots at a very high level, different spots on the floor. A lot of what they do is trigger toward getting him shots. The best teams in the country, to me, know where the ball should end up when shots need to be taken, and he is their guy.
You know what I like about him? He played at Seton Hall Prep over New Jersey for a guy named Bob Farrell. A lot of ball movement. He's the same guy that coached Brevin Knight and Brandon Knight. Comes out of a guard-oriented high school program. It's very important for a really good high school player to learn how to play without the ball, and he does.
Oriaki back on the floor with 3 fouls. He gets the basket. You know, we showed you the replay of the threes. The hand of the defender on each three was in the same spot, and as Mark Jackson likes to say, our ESPN colleague, you know the rule. Hand down, man down. Here's Gibbs again. This time the defender got into his grill, and Napier forcing Gibbs to give it up. Wanamaker to the bucket. Got it to roll home.
Wanamaker
a little shaken up.
Yeah.
Holding his left thumb.
One of the toughest guys in the league. Mike Bray said, you may not be able to find a more respected guy in the Big East Conference. A little old school, friend. Does a little bit of everything.
If Oriaki becomes a factor here in the second half, he's had an up and down season. 9.5 points per game on the year, 8 rebounds. They've gone to him on consecutive possessions. He'll go to the line here, got a field goal last time. Taylor picking up the foul. That's his second. Second on Pitt.
Now you mentioned a toughness. When you think about it, Doris, this whole program has been built around toughness. Bradley Wanamaker wanted to go to Temple. His mom said to get out of the city, go to Pittsburgh, and it's paid off pretty good. Now he's banged up. Let's see how he reacts when he comes back.
All right, Mike. Larry Fitzgerald, former Pitt wide receiver and currently the best wide receiver in the NFL, along with Nick Faldo, now doing TV, pro golfer here in the crowd at MSG. Oh. Out your bracket until you spend Selection Sunday with us. Coverage starts Bracketology 3 Eastern, then at 6. Catch Sports Center for wall-to-wall coverage of the brackets, and at 7, our experts break it all down in 2 hours of Bracketology presented by Sunday.
Well, I majored in American History at Brooklyn College.
Presented by Staples, excuse me.
With a minor in Bracketology. I'll be up there Sunday. That's going to be a lot of fun.
Alex Oriaki at the line. By the way, I was talking with Larry Fitzgerald at halftime because, you know, we're boys. And I asked Larry about what he thinks of Jamie Dixon, and he said he watches a lot of college basketball. He thinks Jamie does more with less than any coach in the country. And it's hard to argue with that assessment. Or the hair.
You're boys. I like that. You're a football guy. Well, that's to our point about no first-round draft picks in the history of Pittsburgh's program, yet they've been the single most consistent.
Wanamaker got 2 defenders in the air and scores.
Now, you can see why coaches value this guy. He's old school. A little up fake. Scoring against bigger defenders, Fran.
Yep, we used to call him a Philly guard, but the way that Pittsburgh has developed guys like LaVance Fields and Brandon Knight, now Bradley Wanamaker, he's a Pittsburgh guard. Young man that played with Malik Waynes in high school at Roman Catholic.
Napier, wild shot. Oriaki got to be careful not to go over the back and get that 4th foul, and it was touched last. by Pittsburgh.
How about the defense? How about those guys getting in a stance? This guy is a tremendous breakdown ball handler and can get by a lot of individual defenders. And Pittsburgh sits in a stance and refuses to let him get by.
Well, you said something early in the broadcast, Doris. Pittsburgh is consistent. Everything they do, every practice, every drill, building habits defensively, offensively, consistency of effort.
Lamb inside, counted, and a foul on Pittsburgh. J.J. Richardson picking it up, his first. And the third on Pitt.
What a confidence builder this has to be for this young team. We're watching Jeremy Lamb grow up before our eyes. Remember, during the regular season, he had 8 straight double-figure games in conference play. Wasn't heavily recruited, and you love the fact that Jim Calhoun has had 23 NBA players and only 7 McDonald's All-Americans. He's a developer.
4-point game again. 6 minutes gone by here in the second half. Ashton Gibbs got to give it up. Is that 5? Certainly close. Gibbs 8 of 9 from the field, 5 of 5 from 3, 22 points. Kemba Walker has 16. Lamb with 11 for UConn. Shot clock down to 6. Robinson swooping through the lane, able to get it to go with the right hand.
No, they're not even letting him get to the pick and roll. You see that early trap, Doris?
Backdoor pass, Walker, blow by and basket.
Great communication. That's Shabazz looking at it, and it's nonverbal. It's a simple exchange of eye contact between Napier and Walker. You clear the entire left side of the floor. You clear any help.
Brown gets down the lane. Both teams getting baskets around the rim here in the last couple of minutes. 6-point contest, Pitt on top. Panthers the 1 seed, Connecticut the 9 seed. St. John's Syracuse up next here on ESPN in quarterfinal number 2. Walker with a step back, thought about it, instead gave it up to Napier. Moriaki tangled up with Richardson, and that's 2 fouls on Richardson, 4 on Pitt.
Connecticut hanging tough, and a little communication here by Shabazz Napier, the point guard, and Kemba Walker, who's playing the 2 guard. You get Alex Oriaki, everybody's above the free throw line. A little line draw. Thank you, Fran. Good backdoor cut. You understand that Pittsburgh's going to cheat up into the passing lane, and Kemba gets Mr. Gilbert Brown stumbling backwards.
That's taking advantage of Pittsburgh's pressure.
Yes.
It's kind of like playing judo, you know, you flip it around on your opponent. They pressure, you take advantage of it.
You took judo?
No, I just heard about that once.
Oriaki. And he's coming alive here in the second half.
Well, it speaks to what we said earlier in this game. When you play a tough, physical, aggressive team, you must match their toughness. And from the early part of this game, UConn has gone after Pittsburgh.
Oriaki has 6 in the second half, 8 points for the game. Woodall being defended by Napier. Gibbs off the McGee screen. And a good strip. Here's Walker again in transition. No contest, but he blew the layup. And a foul on the floor on Pittsburgh. On McGee, that's 4 on him.
You better match the physical and mental toughness that Jamie Dixon's team's going to put at you. Fran said it from the opening tip. They have been up to the task. Alex Oriaki goes right by McGee. That's big body on big body. Alex gets the advantage. And the UConn Huskies showing a little bite. Oh, yeah, we're rolling in New York City.
Back at the Garden, points off turnovers, 15-0 in favor of Connecticut. Huskies back within 4. Take a look at our journey to the brackets brought to you by Dove Men Care. First, let's take a look at the bracket. We've got Syracuse St. John's coming up next. And then the winner of our game here will meet the winner of that game tomorrow in 1 semifinal. 2 more quarterfinal games tonight, including Marquette against Louisville. And Marquette, you'd have to think, they weren't already in Got to be in now after their win over West Virginia,
yeah,
right?
And what you love about these guys is Buzz Williams has four junior college players in the starting lineup. And if you get to know those guys, they're all quality people. To integrate guys like Jimmy Butler and Jake Crowder, Dwight Bikes, and DJO is remarkable.
Three-pointer in and out for Coombs McDaniel. So at this point, it's looking like 11 Big East teams, right?
It really is. I don't think you can argue Marquette at this point. That argument's over. You couple those wins we just showed you with all the close losses, and that team just flat out does not get blown out.
Villanova have anything to worry about?
Not unless some teams really get hot and steal some bids. I don't think so. Their body of work over the season has been solid.
They're having a hard time with this year, Robinson. When he decides to put it on the deck, they have not done a good job with him.
I mean, he's that classic matchup problem we've talked about, Doris. He's like one of those mid-major forwards that is hard to guard because he's a tweener.
Coombs McDaniel's wide open underneath. Lamb couldn't hit him. Just to finish up on that point about the Big East teams in the NCAA tournament, as Walker stripped. Talking to coaches, they didn't think that would be the case throughout the season, but looks like that's the only case right now, because just not a very good bubble. There are not a lot of teams out there. As you look at Joel and Artie's bracketology, you say, yeah, that team should definitely be in, or that team should definitely be not in.
I think the bigger question, frankly, is how many are around on the second weekend. Last year it was only two, I believe. That's the bigger question.
West Virginia made it to the Final Four last year after winning the Big East tournament. They lost last night in their first game. A steal by Lamb, and Lamb soaring for the jam, making it a four-point game again.
You know, smart play by Nasir Robinson. He's the one who made the mistake. And how many times, friend, do you see guys compound it? He knew Jeremy Lamb had him beat, and he didn't compound it by fouling.
No, I agree. I agree. And you know what? Lamb and Napier are two very pesky defenders, especially for freshmen. Look at the arm. Look at the length of Lamb.
And that's 17 points off of turnovers for UConn to none for Pitt. Almost another giveaway by the Panthers. Now, UConn's only turned it over six times, but still Pitt unable to capitalize as Walker's on the floor, and he's fouled by Taylor. That's his third.
I couldn't be more impressed with the defense Connecticut is playing as Taylor's slow to get up. Their reactions, Fran, are very fast. They're closing hard. There's great ball pressure. Here's one mistake. Nasir, a little casual pass. Good anticipation by Jeremy Lamb. Next play. Nasir, you're beat. You made a mistake. Okay. And look at this. Hustling, scrapping, fighting.
I think regardless of what happens in this game, this has been a huge confidence builder over the 3 days for UConn. Coming in losing 4 out of 5, Dave. I watched them Saturday against Notre Dame, and they really looked like they've lost their confidence.
Meanwhile, Dante Taylor hobbled to the bench. Remember, one of their other bigs, Tali Zana, is out until perhaps the NCAA tournament. With a broken right thumb. Three-pointer good by Napier. One-point game.
Hand down, man down.
That guy, what a future Shabazz Napier has in a UConn jersey.
Well, again, a tribute, Mark Jackson, on the comment. As there's a foul called.
There's a perfect example. Foul. Watch the hand go down. It drops. That actually is pretty good, isn't it? Pretty good contest.
Napier then picking up a foul on the other end, his first. You see Kemba Walker with the encouragement. Jim Calhoun says he has loved coaching Kemba Walker as much as any player he's had.
Well, you're a young guy. I mean, how good does that feel? You know, Kemba's saying pretty good. Good job, young fella.
Walker's a junior, but he did take part on senior day over the weekend for non-basketball reasons. He's due to graduate. But perhaps going pro anyway as he gets the rebound off the miss by Patterson. UConn looking to take the lead again. And Walker off the mark. Giffey keeps it alive. Oriaki out to Lamb.
Very rare that Pittsburgh gets beat to 50-50 balls. You see what I mean about the quick reactions of Connecticut, and I'm talking about both ends. They're pursuing the ball.
Connecticut's only lead was late in the first half before Woodall hit a shot at the end. Alley-oop, Oriaki. Missed once, but not twice. UConn back on top.
First possession is zone. UConn recognized it. They threw it over the top. This is a young team growing up before your eyes.
You gotta want it. And they are pursuing the basketball with reckless abandon. There's great ball pressure. There's active hands, quick feet, diving for loose basketballs. The lob pass. Oriaki makes sure he's got it. Stays persistent, Fran. Nicely done.
Oriaki really playing well here in the second half. Was pretty much a non-factor in the first half. Didn't do a whole lot yesterday against Georgetown. He dominated the game against DePaul as the officials are looking at the monitor here. A clock malfunction, perhaps, is what we're being told. But Oriaki has been terrific here in the second half. 10 points, 8 since intermission. You see the clock stop there.
You can see they're trying to set the, I know they're looking at the clock, but they were trying to set their zone up, and good recognition by UConn. They threw it right over the top.
About 3-4 seconds that they'll likely add on here.
Dave, when you think about Pittsburgh and you think about the fact that, and I say this in a complimentary way, they've bullied teams all year. They've bullied good teams with their physical play. And I've said it so many times, when you play a bully, when you fight a bully, you've got to get the first punch in. And even though Ashton Gibbs was hot early, we made the point that UConn was competing. And now that he's cooled off, they haven't gotten him as many shots. The fact that they absorbed the first few blows from the bully has shaken the bully.
Are you experienced in that matter?
With judo?
No, Brooklyn.
So Connecticut leads by one with 8:26 to go. They put 6 seconds back on.
Yeah, thanks to the officials for that clarity. 6 seconds.
Excuse me, 6 seconds off, obviously, because the clock was stopped and game action is continuing. So 8:20.
And they're doing this without Roscoe Smith, who had the 8 stitches, and they're going to save him. He's hopefully be back next week in the NCAA tournament.
Jim, with that little bit smaller lineup out there for UConn, with Okwandu on the bench seemingly having more success, as Wanamaker and Walker are going at it on the low block. Here's Gibbs off the bounce. Ashton Gibbs having a terrific game. He's missed one shot. 24 points. Maybe you want him shooting more. He's only taken 10. He's 5 of 5 from 3.
I think the beauty is he's picked his spots, because UConn's done a reasonably good job. Giffey was all over him.
Lamb fouled by Brown. That's the 17th foul on Pitt. Second on Gilbert Brown. Pitt wasn't there, although Syracuse is the only team to beat St. John's here at Madison Square Garden this year. They blew him out during the regular season. But Pitt shooting 61%, yet we got a tie game as Lamb hits the first free throw.
Well, and here's why. I don't think I've ever seen this kind of ratio. Connecticut has forced 11 Pittsburgh turnovers, usually so solid with the basketball. Not only have they forced them, Fran, but then they've taken advantage of it. Pittsburgh is the kind of team that you've got to beat them for 40 minutes. You can't beat them for 8 or 12 or 10. You've got to beat them for 40 minutes.
But I can guarantee in the NCAA tournament there'll be teams at Pittsburgh's level that will watch this game and say, we can run on them. Their transition defense has not been great today.
18 points for Walker, 15 now for Lamb, who's had a great Big East tournament. 24 for Gibbs. Wanamaker with a 3. And Wanamaker now with 15. Pitt back up 2 at the 7-minute mark.
You'd expect that from your seniors, right? Taking over, making shots at big points.
Had the baseline cut off. Here's Lamb. He'll raise. Too strong on a 3, but Giffey with the offensive rebound. Here's Oriaki. Can't finish. Lamb, one more try.
They're doing the job on the outfield. We came out of that last time out with Connecticut having had 9 offensive rebounds. They had a couple more to the tally.
That's a great point, because Pittsburgh has not done the job on their offensive glass today.
Walker fouled by Kemba Walker. It's only the first on him, fifth team foul on UConn.
Bradley Wanamaker, a guy that's self-made, got better each year. This year he's one of the team leaders, one of the best players in the Big East. And then Jeremy Lamb, you talk about opportunity to shine. He's certainly taken advantage of it today.
Wanamaker, the Big East Sportsmanship Award winner, also all Big East second team. All Big East first team is made up of all guards, including Ashton Gibbs of Pitt, Kemba Walker of UConn. Here's Wanamaker again, this time short. Walker, very good rebounder, gets that one. Coombs McDaniel, three ball won't go. Out of bounds, UConn will keep.
Alex Oriaki, just by being aggressive, gets them an extra possession. You may not always get the rebound, but you might get yourself a possession. Look at this, 12-5 to a team who normally it's the reverse of that.
And again, UConn's bigs have been on the bench a lot in foul trouble. They're still getting offensive rebounds. Napier for the lead. In and out. Oriaki trying to track it down. And again, UConn gets a possession.
That's two. Now, that will not show up in a stat sheet, but in a film session, Fran, my guess is you are taking a look at that and talking about that young man.
That's toughness. That's toughness. You're exactly right, Doris.
Walker going right back at Wanamaker. Kemba Walker gets the bounce. Connecticut by two.
Well, it's a street fight. It's been that way for 35 minutes.
20 points for Kemba Walker as Connecticut has its largest lead. They've been down for most of the game. Gibbs to the rim, though. Taylor working hard. Got it the second time.
That is a man's rebound in there. Gibbs made the right read. Defender was locking and trailing the whole way. He went right to the rim.
And Kemba Walker said before the game, fatigue would not be a factor for us. Three games in 3 days. Look at those freshmen. They've logged a lot of minutes.
Here's Walker again. Short. Walker got the offensive rebound. Stick back is there.
Tough twos. Tough twos. I mean, how many tough twos have we seen this guy make in 2.5 days?
If you weren't convinced before this weekend that Kemba Walker at 6'1" can play in the NBA, I think you should be after watching this. Even as really a non-traditional point guard, as the follow is good by Taylor, his second field goal.
Well, what he is, he's a punt returner. His speed changes games.
But Dante Taylor, if he doesn't condition himself and drop the weight he dropped, those last two baskets aren't even possible. He can't get up and down the floor and play in this physical game, but he's leaner and meaner, and he's made two huge hoops.
Coombs McDaniel, no. Oriaki missed the dunk, but he was fouled. Gary McGee out of the game right now with four fouls. And another foul inside on Pittsburgh. Free throws coming up for UConn.
Sit tight. Grab a beverage. We've got a Big East ball game, folks. Two of the toughest teams in the entire country going blow for blow. Kemba Walker, likely a first-team All-American. Tough two after tough two. We're knotted at 69.
You got that right, Mike. And I know we're going to have for dessert as we got a tie game, 3:26 remaining, as we look at our Reese's perfect play.
Well, when you grow up on the playgrounds of the Bronx, there's nothing about jump shooting. The wind's blowing, there's no nets on the rim. You got to operate around the basket. And the littlest guy on the floor today has done that. More about toughness than it is even his great speed and quickness.
Played so well in the tournament. Remember, coming into this tournament, he was shooting about 23% from the field in games here at Madison Square Garden. He's from the Bronx, so you know he wanted to turn that around, that he has.
This is how I think he has to go. I think he has to go to the NBA. His stock may never be higher. It's not the most potent draft in the history of the NBA.
Yeah, you're right, Doris, and his stock has certainly risen over the course not only of the entire season, but doing it the last 3 days in front of a bevy of NBA scouts. He's got NBA speed, you know, the open court game, the spacing's different.
One of two for Oriaki. He's got 11 points, four offensive rebounds. And UConn leads by one as we approach the three-minute mark. Winner advances to tomorrow night's semifinal game against either Syracuse or St. John's.
We're going to find out about Pittsburgh's toughness in the last 3 minutes.
And a foul on Lamb, 16 foul. And the second personal on Lamb. He's had a very good tournament, averaging about 15 points per game in the three contests.
Looks like they want to try to post up, because we've talked about the smaller lineup. They're trying to post Connecticut up at different matchups. Let's see if they work that here.
Brown got Lamb in the air, short with a two. Lamb with the board. Can UConn extend a one-point lead? Their largest advantage was two, as Robinson just picked up his fourth. McGee already with four, and both are on the floor. Do you keep them both on the floor here if you're Jamie Dixon?
I think you do. 3 minutes to go in a game. It's become a three-minute game right now. No reason to save them.
And so Shabazz Napier at the line. Connecticut 19 of 23 as a team at the strike today. Napier has yet to attempt a foul shot, but was 74% on the season. We'll have one more. 19 foul on Pitt.
And I mentioned to you, Doris, a couple times this week, this young guy has got that Big East DNA. And even though he's taken a back seat this freshman season to Kemba Walker, he and Jeremy Lamb are going to blossom once Kemba leaves. In a sense, he's letting them spread their wings.
I think he knows he needs them.
Good point.
UConn fans on their feet here at the Garden as they have their largest advantage, 3 points. Gibbs has 24 points on the day. His first missed three, and Oriaki with another rebound.
There were moments where they were looking to post up Wanamaker on Kemba. They've got Gilbert Brown with Jeremy Lamb checking him. I'm surprised they're not looking to go inside a little bit more, Pittsburgh.
How about this? Pitt does not like to play zone. They're in a 2-3 zone right now.
Walker off the heel. Here's Gibbs out. And fast break finds Wanamaker. And Walker called for the foul. He thought he had all ball. Ran all the way down to Jim Calhoun. And that's a second foul on Walker. 17 foul.
Boy. Bang, bang, play. Looked like he had all ball, guys.
Maybe he didn't even get the ball. I don't even know if he even touched the ball or the defender here.
Oh, boy.
He got the ball.
Boy. Come on now. Don't anticipate. Just call what you see, but don't anticipate.
See why Kemba went down to Jim Calhoun. He was looking for a little assistance and maybe a little noise being made.
Yeah, it's a tough call, but you've got to stay. Everybody on the floor now has got to stay focused.
It's a good place to go if you're looking to someone for someone to comfort you after you feel like you got a bad call against you, your head coach. And Pittsburgh 0-2 with the double bye. Teams since they went to this format a couple years ago, 3-5 in the quarterfinals that have had the double bye. So 2 minutes to go, UConn on top by one. The major conference tournaments around the country all going on now, with the Big Ten tournament getting started on ESPN2 at 4:30 with Iowa, Michigan State. Ohio State will play tomorrow. Based on what you guys watched in the regular season, is Ohio State the best team? I know they're number one in the country. Are they the best team in college basketball?
You know, I think Kansas has the deepest, most talented team, but as we've seen today, they don't stay as focused. Ohio State with four upperclassmen, three seniors, and then a brilliant freshman, Doris. They have great balance of inside and out.
I just love the way they're made up. I mean, you've got Diebler who can put 8 to 10 threes on the board. You've got toughness with David Leidy. You've got the inside game with Sullinger. I mean, there's just a lot of really good pieces with a terrific coach in Thad Matta. And a 2-3 zone by Pittsburgh. Where does Connecticut go to attack it?
Well, they're 1-for-1. They picked up a foul and then the missed jumper.
Here's Kemba Walker, 22 points, 5 assists, and the shot clock inside 10 seconds. Walker over two defenders, can't get the bounce. Pit ball trailing by one. It's in the hands of Ashton Gibbs. Each team with a pair of timeouts. Possession arrow favors the Panthers. Both teams in the bonus. Wanamaker off target. Walker rebounds.
What a terrific job by Napier. Another guy who's going against a pretty good defender, Wanamaker. Just make it a hard play. Make him shoot over the top. Nice job by Napier. His competitive spirit is outstanding.
Pitts out of the zone now. Back to man. So you'll see pick and roll for Walker.
Oriaki sets the screen. Walker keeps. Walker drives on Wanamaker. Wild shot. Oriaki put back. The lead is three for UConn. Timeout Pittsburgh. Napier and Gibbs got tangled up under the basket. A little extracurricular activity, but no call. One timeout remaining for the Panthers.
The reason this is important is a dribble drive, even if you don't make the shot, you have broken down the defense, Fran, and that gets other defenders reacting. Gary McGee is forced to come over to give a challenge, and this is why Oriaki is available in the weak side glass.
I almost believe, Doris, I can't wait to ask him after the game, I almost think he shot the ball knowing that he would draw the two bigs, because when they celebrated going back to the bench, he had a big smile and he hugged Oriaki as to say, you brought two with me and you got to get the reward.
Oh, that's great.
Oriaki has had a great second half. Four offensive rebounds and 11 points since intermission, and he's been so up and down. They've been waiting for him to put a run together because they feel they can do something in the NCAA tournament if he's there for them each game.
Best motivator is the pine, and Jim Calhoun sat him, made him come off the bench for a couple of games. He said, "Bella, I need you to rebound. I'm not asking you to solve the theory of relativity. Just go get me the basketball," and he has responded in a big way.
Under a minute left, Pitt down three. Here's Gibbs for the tie. It's there! A new career high, 27 points for Ashton Gibbs. Former Panther Larry Fitzgerald loving it. That's the 6-3 for Gibbs.
When you're guarding a shooter late in the game, you must stay attached. You cannot cheat the screen. Stay with him. Stay on his body. Napier goes under, and you're giving a guy with dynamite a chance to blow up the building. Take a look. He goes under the screen. You must stay attached if you're going to guard a guy with that kind of shooting ability.
That's unusual because we have seen them lock and trail the entire game. Young mistake by Mr. Napier.
And the West Orange, New Jersey natives' best two games have come at the Garden. 26 against St. John's in the regular season, 27 today.
The first team all Big East member. A little chip on their shoulder. They thought he should have been player of the year. He's played like one. It's been an efficient afternoon. But one thing this guy has not done, Fran, is take a bad shot. Everything has come within the flow. Look at the kind of space. They run staggers, doubles, flares. They want this guy to get shots.
What have we said about Pittsburgh? They have a culture of execution. They screen hard, they move the ball, and their shot selection is impeccable.
You expect Pitt to come back to man, or do they go to the zone?
Now I think, you know what, Jamie Dixon is 99.9% man-to-man. I think they go man because that's their bread and butter. And if you go zone, you're telling your team you don't have the confidence to guard the players on the floor for UConn.
Kemba Walker would scare the heck out of me against a man-to-man.
It looks like they're going man with, again, Wanamaker, who defended Walker well last possession. About a 12-second difference between game and shot clocks.
You know what, Dave? There's a situation where sometimes you don't need a screen for Kemba Walker. You see him telling him?
Yeah. Now Oriaki will set it. Plenty of time to shoot. Walker with 10. Walker driving on Wanamaker. Pull up. Short. Rebound Coombs McDaniel and a timeout. What a heads-up play by Coombs McDaniel. Didn't need to try to force a shot because the game's tied. Take the timeout.
Well, both he and Coach Calhoun. As soon as the rebound came, Coach Calhoun was up and tried to call a timeout.
Wow. Watch this heads-up play by Coombs McDaniel. You talk about being in city traffic right here. He's got the rock and he's got the timeout.
Smart play,
yes,
by a sophomore.
Is. Yep, you're right, Dave. You know how many guys would have traveled or run somebody over or tried to shoot it?
So what are we seeing here from UConn with 18 seconds left?
Who do you go to?
Kemba Walker this year has thrived in these situations. Game winners or go-ahead baskets in the final 3 minutes of five games, including against Texas, and maybe the best road win out of conference for anybody this year. Also did it on January 17th against Villanova. And on January 19th, he did it as well, and we'll see if he gets it here. 18 seconds left. UConn still has a timeout.
And let's be honest, that last shot was an outstanding shot.
Absolutely.
He got Brad Wanamaker committed.
This is one of those situations, guys, where Kemba Walker does not need a screen. If you bring two more players into the action, you're liable to get the ball taken out of his hands. He's going to take the last shot. He should shoot it under five. But whatever he does, I would not screen for him and just give him room to operate. He's unguardable in a one-on-one situation in terms of creating his own offense.
Kemba Walker in the second half, only 4 of 14 shooting. He's 7 of 21 for the game, 22 points. And Walker inbound the ball, and now he gets it back. Guarded by Wanamaker with 10 seconds to go. Coombs McDaniel on the screen. Walker with 7.
Got a mismatch.
Walker on McGee with 4. Kemba Walker. Step back. Walker. Cardiac Kemba does it again. UConn wins at the buzzer.
It was a big to little exchange, and you put all the duress on Gary McGee, who at his size trying to check Kemba Walker. Looks like he's going to be able to prohibit it, but he just goes a hard dribble at separation. Step back, money, Kemba.
You know what, guys? This is why Jim Calhoun is in the Hall of Fame, and I'm not. Because the ball screen at the top created the switch, and once he had the switch, he had Gary McGee in jail. What a great call by Jim Calhoun and the execution by this little guy who's been amazing all year.
No question, he got it off. No reason to go to the monitor. It was clear it left his hand with about a second to go, so no controversial ending at all. It's good. Connecticut wins 76-74. Jamie Dixon's team now 0-3 with the double bye. And Calhoun's club moving on. Kemba Walker with the game-winning shot. His mom, Andrea, is watching, and you can see right away her reaction as Walker drained it. Beth Moen standing by with Calhoun and Kemba.
Thank you very much, Dave. Well, describe for us, Jim, how you set up the play to get the mismatch for Kemba on that last shot.
Yeah, well, they've been switching the whole game on that with a hot switch. So we said, let's go back to our original game plan, which was to try to get McGee, who's a terrific player, but not quite a match for Kemba outside the paint. And Kemba just made a great, great play. And that's why he's the best player, in my opinion, in this league and as good as it is in the country.
What was the challenge, not only for Kemba, but for all the guys to match the toughness that Pittsburgh was going to bring today?
We didn't early. Quite frankly, we didn't early. And with about 10 minutes to go, we had a little talk on the sidelines, and we decided, hey, we got nothing to lose except a basketball game, but let's not lose our pride and go out and play. And these guys did an incredible, incredible job.
Obviously, the points off of turnovers were crucial, but I think the offensive rebounds there over the last couple of minutes were a major difference for you. Coming against the second-best rebounding team in the country, what was the challenge for Oriaki in that second half?
Yeah, Alex had just stepped up at a big time. And then the second thing, really, if you think about it, Jamal Coombs not only gets a rebound, but calls timeout to set up the winning play at the end.
Well, congratulations, Jim. Thank you. I want to ask Kemba right now. Kemba, you're a New York guy. How many times have you hit that shot? shot in your childhood growing up in this area and now getting a chance to do it on the big stage?
Growing up, I wasn't really much of a big scorer. I was really a defensive player, but, you know, I'm one of the more experienced guys in this team, and, you know, everybody in the world know that I'm going to take that shot, and, you know, my teammates count on me, and, you know, I just wanted to make the big shot for my team.
You know, we were talking to your mother earlier. She told us you used to be a hip-hop dancer. You've performed on one of the other big stages here in New York, up in Harlem, the Apollo Theater. How does this match up an opportunity to win a game for your ball club here at Madison Square Garden?
Man, this is probably the biggest thing ever. Big East tournament, you know, one of the best leagues in the country, and to hit a game winner, you know, against one of the, you know, best teams in our league is a special moment.
What was it like for you, and how did you keep your composure when you saw that it was McGee on you on the switch?
Well, you know, I knew I could use my quickness on him, and, you know, I wanted the clock to go down so I get the last shot. You know, that's what I did. You know, I was able to break him down and, you know, get a clean look at the rim.
How would you describe the play once again today of the freshmen in their first postseason, Napier and Lamb, continually making big plays for you?
Man, those two guys were special tonight. You know, it was times where I struggled. I couldn't score. They were playing me extremely hard, and those two guys just stepped up and, you know, made a big play for this team.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Dave?
Kemba Walker now 6 times this year with the game winner or the go-ahead basket in the final 3 minutes.
And tell you what, Dave, every star needs a supporting cast. And this rebound was likely to end up the second biggest play of the game. The timeout call, the presence of mind by Jamal Coombs McDaniel, the sophomore, gives Kemba Walker a chance to do his magic one more time.
And Walker hits the game winner to send Connecticut to play on Friday night in one semifinal against either Syracuse or St. John's. That game up next, Notre Dame, Cincinnati, Louisville, Marquette tonight. 24 points for Walker. Lamb had 17, Oriaki 13, and 7 rebounds. Walker with the step back J as Connecticut knocks off Pitt 76-74. Coming up next, college basketball scoreboard with Mike Tirico and company. But don't go too far, as we've got more basketball from Madison Square Garden in about 20 minutes. As Syracuse takes on St. John's for Doris Burke, Fran Fraschilla, our entire crew, Dave Pasch, so long from MSG, not a Mike Tirico, Doug Gottlieb in the studio.